Good evening, everybody. Could you take your seats so we can try and begin? Boy, that was outstanding quieting down. I'm amazed. My name is Dave Wallace. I'm getting the signal I need to speak louder or hold the microphone up better. Is that working? Dave Wallace, I'm the Community Development Director. And I just want to do some introductions and a little bit of preliminary background on where we are in this whole process, and then we'll get into the main part of the program. So first, for introductions, I want to introduce some of our council members who are here. I know I saw Council Member Pat Eklund in the back, Council Member Denise Athos, and Council Member Madeline Kellner right here. On city staff, we have our city manager in the back, Michael Frank. Our assistant city manager is here also in the back door, Cathy Capriola. Planning staff, who's working on the housing element update, our planning manager, Liz Dunn, and the senior planner, Hans Grund. In introductions for the people who are here to speak to you and with you, we have representative from Housing and Community Development with the state. Cathy Creswell is the deputy director, and Melinda Benson, who is a senior person there, and we're lucky enough to have her reviewing our housing element. And then with ABAG, we have Paul Fassinger, who's the director of research. Is that right? I got the terminology right. Okay. So a little bit of background where we are in the process. As many of you know, there was a Planning Commission hearing in the beginning of June. That hearing was intended to discuss the site selection criteria and housing opportunity sites. We heard a tremendous outcry from the community about the sites that were being proposed for consideration. And at that point, we took a step back and we said we need to better engage the community. So what you're seeing tonight is one of the major steps in that process, and it is still an early step in that process. This is a workshop to try and give you, the community, an opportunity to hear from the state and regional agencies that you've expressed a lot of interest in and want to know how they interact with the local jurisdiction. We're also going to be doing additional workshops to try and address other issues that have been raised, issues such as how can we get involved in those state and regional policies and try and have some influence on that so that it's not just them speaking with us, but us speaking back to them. Discussions about crime and housing, discussions about design and density and those kinds of issues. So there are going to be more of these workshops for you to have an opportunity to be engaged, learn from us what we're looking at and thinking about, and give us feedback back on those issues. Coming back to tonight, I want to go into one more thing. So the other thing that's going on is we are putting together the city manager's working group. That is something that we've been talking about since probably the beginning of September when we had that large public workshop. We are in the process right now of contacting potential members. We've got commitments for 16 people. We're hoping to get a few more engaged for that, and we hope to be releasing the names of all the people who are going to participate in that committee next week. That group is going to be meeting over the coming months to look at, in particular, the housing opportunity sites. We know that that's a big part of the concern of the community, and so we're going to be having them looking at those sites and providing their recommendations. Should we eliminate some of those sites from the list? Should we modify some of those sites? Should we add new sites? We're going to be looking at that to them for input on those issues, and then of course other housing issues, density and those kinds of things that go along with those housing issues. So there will be all different representatives on that group. From neighborhoods, from various different interests. Yes, it has. And as I say, when we release the names of the members of the group, I think you'll see that there's going to be a very wide representation of residential areas throughout the community. Okay, going back to tonight's presentation, getting prepared for this meeting, what staff did is gather a lot of the comments and questions that we had heard from you at previous meetings. As you came in the door, we gave you a printout of those. Those are all comments and questions that came from you. Those were not developed by staff. Those were community questions and comments. We sent those to ABAG and HCD so that they could be prepared to address those comments and questions. To the extent that it works into their presentation, they will do that, but then they will be available for you to just directly ask questions of them and get more information. And our facilitator, I'll introduce in just a moment, will be directing how that conversation goes, but we are looking at all of you to freely put new questions, to repeat questions from this list that you've previously submitted, but to go ahead and try and get all of your issues out on the table and get information from ABAG and from HCD. From there, I do want to introduce Steve Thomas, standing against the wall. He's going to be moderating the rest of the meeting. We on staff know that this is a very emotionally charged issue for the community, and we thought it was important to get someone who's used to working with large groups and is neutral and does not have any defined interests here. But Steve does have a tremendous amount of experience working with government and community groups, and we'll be looking to him to just organize the presentations and the conversations that go on from here. And I think with that, I'm just going to turn it over to Steve and we'll go from there.
Good evening. Thank you. We should check it here. Thank you. It's really encouraging to see a community with this many people engaged and government and shaping their city. I don't often see this many people in a community meeting. As a matter of fact, lots of decisions get made at a city council or at a county board of supervisors, commissions, school boards, where there's really critical input and they don't have it from the community they're serving. That's hard to drag them out. I'm kind of curious myself, how many of you would be here if the Phillies and the playing tonight? I'm not sure. I know that I might not be here for that. But so I want to thank all of you for being here. I think it's a testament to the commitment to your quality of life and your testament to the city, your engagement. I'd love to be able to show this at a Civics 101 class at the university. That being said, we have some guests we've invited. David has explained to me the process to date. There's a lot of strong feelings around the housing element, the plan. I wish that wouldn't do that.
Yeah. Keep on this side.
This side?
Yeah.
You'll have to watch me over here. That being said, we have an opportunity tonight to do some education, to learn some stuff from a couple of key agencies. The city has represented to me they want a transparent process. When they put together the group that Dave was talking about, the advisory council for the city manager, they are deliberately looking to get every possible kind of demographic that they can get so that they can come together and work together for you. That does not mean they're going to be making decisions for you. Does not mean any decisions are going to be made tonight. What it means is, tonight, you get a chance to talk to these two agencies. We're going to have, they're going to do a couple presentations based on all of the data and the questions that you had before. They have prepared some presentations. And so we're going to have them do those presentations. Afterwards, we're going to have some question and answer. And I'll get into how we'll handle that after the fact. And then hopefully, by the time we end tonight, we'll all have a better understanding of why this is such a hot and contentious issue. And maybe it's not. Maybe we just need to be able to talk with each other. Okay. So I haven't seen it yet. So there's no weapons, no bottles, none of that stuff, right? We got all those stuff outside. Okay. So when we have a community meeting like this, and there's such a large group, everybody has an idea of what they want to have come out of it. Everybody has a question or several questions they want to have answered. They even want to be able to say to somebody or their neighbors what's on their minds. And so how we do that defines our civic culture. And so I'm going to ask all of you to be civil tonight. Be no personal attacks against anybody. Everyone's truth is their own. And if we can have that conversation tonight, we may just be able to get everybody an opportunity to speak and ask questions. And in order to do that, you have to be very succinct. You have to be on point, right? And we don't want anybody really hogging the air. So with that said, we're going to move to the next part of this presentation. Can we all agree that we're going to try and behave and comport ourselves as human beings? We may have some strong feelings. We're not going to personalize it. We're going to make our point known, get our questions asked, and we're going to learn. Is everybody okay with that tonight?
Absolutely.
Okay, good. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to turn it over to, I think it's HCD, Cathy and Melinda. They're going to make a presentation addressing with the PowerPoint some of your questions and some of the information they understand to be meaningful to you. I'm sure they won't cover everything, but we'll give them an opportunity to be able to do that first, okay? Thank you.
Hello, can you hear me? Great. Well, I'm Cathy. I'm very grateful to be here. Melinda has been working with your planning staff on your housing element. So is familiar with the community. But we are very grateful to have the opportunity to talk to you tonight, to explain to you what our role is, what our job is, to try to share information with you about the law and about our responsibilities, and hopefully to be able to answer some of your questions and about to answer some things that are of concern to you. We see our role as being partners with local communities, and so we are always really grateful for the opportunity to come out and hear from you and try to give you as much information as we can so that you can understand how the statute operates and can better figure out what's in the best interest for your community. So we've prepared a fairly brief presentation about the statute that talks about some of the issues that you raised in questions, but it's more designed to kind of give you an overview of what the law is, why the law was established, sort of our role versus local government's role, the regional role, and then to leave plenty of opportunity for you to respond to those things and then just ask any kind of questions you have about what your concerns are. And hopefully how we might be able to work together and meet the interests both of the state as well as local communities. So with that, it works backwards. That's kind of cool. I don't have to point this. But so what we're going to try to cover tonight is want to talk a little bit about why the law is in effect, and that really relates to local housing needs in general, about the state and local role in addressing housing needs, what the general requirement, very briefly, of housing element is, just to kind of give you an overview, and then what our role is in the housing element process. But first, we think it's always important to start from, when you're looking at housing elements, really what it's about. And it's about addressing the needs of the people who live in your community and ensuring that everybody in California and in communities who are vital parts of your community have the opportunity to live in a safe and decent and affordable place. And to kind of put, we think it's important sometimes to put a face to the people who need housing. So it's not just a number. You talk a lot about numbers when you're dealing with the regional housing need and census and all of that. But we think it's important that those numbers represent real people. People that are important in your communities, people that teach your children, people that take care of seniors.
A lot of these income
Yeah, excuse me for a second. I got an automatic fence. It's like a dog who can't go outside the yard there. If we pop up and do questions now, we're going to compromise the ability for a lot of other people to have questions later as well. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to ask you to hold the questions until they make, is everybody okay with that? Until the presentations are done, and then I will give you the opportunity to be able to ask whatever you'd like.
But if it's baloney, do we have to do it?
What's that?
We're just here, but we just like accurate information. But as she pointed out, this is what's been happening for the last 6 months. Inaccurate information, false statements. Oh, this is just, you're wasting everybody's time here.
Let's... So how will you... How many of you are here to say no to this? How many of you are here to say no to this? To the learning and about the projects?
No, no, no. We're here to say no to high density in the lab.
Okay. Well, that's good. That's a great thing to say. Now, is that a policy statement? Was that a policy council decision?
What that gentleman over there said, this is absolute, you have to put boots on to listen to this stuff. I am a farmer, and I don't need affordable housing.
Okay.
I can afford to buy in San Marino, and I have a home there. I don't, you pulled this fluff, and they did it again in one of the meetings at the city council again. Somebody gets up and says, oh, nurses can't afford it, firefighters can't afford it. To that speaker who the last council meeting was years ago is, tell me how many policemen or firemen live in these communities. I don't know. Well,
yeah.
There's one.
Yeah.
I don't know. Okay,
so I want to make sure that everybody understands the purpose of tonight was to give you an opportunity, because if you had questions of HCD, and if you did have a difference of opinion relative to the data points they're using, that you were able to hear that from them, ask them questions. Same thing for ABAG, because they do have policies and regulations around this particular topic. Okay? I understand. Well, then, first you have to know what they are. And so give me a chance. Okay? Well, you will have plenty of chance, but I want to make sure that what the community came out for was a presentation by HCD. They came down from Sacramento and ABAG for this purpose. If we want to do a different meeting...
And you have a public television broadcaster, do you not?
I do.
So you're disseminating wrong information to the entire community.
I'm not... Oh, wait. There. It's not... It's just recording. It's not... Yeah, it's just recording. And the reason why they put it in place was to record all your questions and record all the answers so that everybody would get accurate information. That's why they're recording it. Okay? Uh-huh. Good. So if that's the case, then you have every opportunity, every one of you, to put input. Tonight, Dan, you can do it online. You have elected officials. You have the web and email. Where did the policy come from relative to pursuing high density?
Being told by the government what we're going to get.
And can you fix that?
Fire them.
Not if they insist on disseminating wrong information.
Let's hear what they have to say first. If I was in the house, I invited someone to my house, I would at least let them speak. about what they had to say.
But not about what we want to hear.
We're going to get to what you want to hear. I can guarantee you, I can hear what you're saying. I hear what you're saying.
You don't like it.
No, it makes no difference to me either way. Is that, can we all agree to that? I thought I had an agreement before we started. Okay.
You left some people on that list that you can't afford to buy a house?
Mm-hmm. I'm not getting any of this stuff.
Okay.
You left some people off that list that aren't qualified to buy a house, and that would be pimps, prostitutes, dope dealers.
We'll add that to that thing. Can we all, we want to move forward now and let them make the presentation and ask questions after? Okay, if you want to do that, we will do that. Before we conclude the meeting, we'll get a straw vote, okay? I'll work it.
Now, just 1 second before you go any further, all that stuff you're putting up on there, I have it here, right? Where did it come from? Where did all those facts and figures come from?
Okay.
Who's going to live where and how much they make? Did you survey everybody in Novato to find this out?
I didn't do any of it. I'm just a facilitator. So here's what we're going to do. Here's what we're going to do. They've said that they'd rather just go to the question and answer period and not make the presentation. Is that all right with you?
Yeah.
All right. So now, how are we going to do this in an orderly fashion so everybody gets a chance to ask a question? Okay, so I'm going to take a question from this side. I'm going to take a question from this side. And I'll take a question from that side. I'll get to you in a little bit, miss. And what about the person running bag?
Well, he doesn't have the same thing going as the HCD.
No, he doesn't, but he'll be available for that. Are you okay with that? Yeah. So, we're going to have one here, one here, one here. I'll come back to that side. So, let's try to keep it succinct, make our point known. Ask the question. Thank you, sir. Go ahead.
Okay, I have two questions. The first question is, are these low-income, high-density housing units also being planned for low-income neighborhoods, and if not, why not? That's question number one. The second question is...
All right, go ahead. We're going to try one question at a time. Go ahead.
Okay. All right. Please answer the question.
So I'm sorry. Could you please repeat it?
Are these low-income, high-density housing units also being planned for low-income neighborhoods, and if not, why not?
Well, where the community of Novato plans to provide housing opportunities is up to the up to your community. I can't speak to where your city and where you as residents are planning to accommodate additional housing need. It's up to the community to decide what neighborhoods can accommodate more growth, how you're going to accommodate that growth, and so I can't answer that question because you decide in your community where the growth is going to be accommodated.
Okay, let me be more specific. Are these units being built in low poverty areas of Richmond or San Pablo?
I can tell you in communities throughout California, including the community I live in Sacramento, affordable housing, either subsidized or housing, goes into low-income neighborhoods. It goes into moderate or above moderate income neighborhoods as much as it can, but it usually, most communities strive to put housing, especially housing that's affordable, in a variety of locations in a community, in not just one neighborhood.
My other question is in regard to the people that end up living in these units. A lot has been said by the advocates that say that, and including in your presentation, that policemen and nurses and the people that change your tire and waitresses need a place to live. However, isn't it not true that once this unit is built, it is open to anybody? They don't necessarily have to live or work in Novato, so they could be coming from the East Bay. Is it that not true?
Yes, there is generally most of these programs do not restrict them to a particular location. And in part, that is because in the United States, we have a constitutional ability to travel and right to travel from one place to another. Communities do frequently, though, I will tell you, for programs which they might put their direct dollars in, sometimes give priority to people who live in their community or work in their community. And that has been occurring in a number of communities throughout California.
Go ahead. Let's take the next one.
I'd like to make a couple of comments. I don't even know if I have a question, but I've been a housing advocate since '72. And one of the things that we put into our general plan and our entire planning process is that certain priorities had to be acknowledged. One is that we would not put a lot of subsidized housing in any one neighborhood, that it was intended to be spread around and essentially indistinguishable from private housing. And this worked for about 25 years. And the city council, for whatever reason, I don't know whether it was a mandate, they abandoned those policies. And as a result, we have the two most difficult neighborhoods that are subsidized housing, that have created social problems. They've created the nightmare that we intended to avoid by our policies, and our policies were abandoned, and we're paying the price. And let me tell you, ABAG cannot make us go back to that. And you see it right here. The neighborhoods are not going to accept it. ABAG is going to have to make some accommodation for communities that have suffered from having housing problems that were created by your policies.
Well,
my microphone doesn't sound good. I guess the only answer I have is
here.
Okay.
Sir.
Yes.
You can't wander very far.
Okay, I won't wander very far. At the same time, you started off with your presentation by saying that you were a housing advocate, that things were working when you were able to make affordable housing occur across your community, to have it so that it was essentially indistinguishable from market rate housing. I don't know that ABAG, the agency I work for, has a policy that says housing is supposed to be in particular neighborhoods like that. As Cathy was describing, I'm sorry? It's the density issue. Okay. As Cathy was describing, the process that we have identifies housing by income category, total number by income category, for each of the communities in the Bay Area. We don't demand that anyone puts any particular type of housing in any particular place in the community. There is a difference between bought housing and rental housing. There's no doubt about that. I have no requirements.
Go ahead.
First, I want to say to your comment about, we would certainly agree, and if you have housing developments that have not been well managed and as a result have problems, that's something that should be addressed, because most affordable housing that is built, our department has provided funding for hundreds of affordable housing projects up and down California. We have a 55-year commitment to those projects. We go out and monitor them from every 1 to 3 years. We want to ensure that the public investment in those projects has been maintained, so we make sure that they are maintained in a good and sound condition, that they have rental policies. If you have a project in your community where that is not being, then you have a legitimate issue to work with those project and those property owners to get them to maintain those units and to have occupancy standards that protect both the people who live in those units as well as the surrounding community. So we would agree that if you have problems with them, there is a way to get at it. I will, to the issue about, we do have requirements in state housing element law that require that each community accommodate their share of the growth that's expected to happen in your community by income level.
You expect it. We don't.
The statute expects it, yes. State law does expect it. And most communities have everybody who live in it, from people who make very little money, from people who are retired, from your children who are just starting out, to people hopefully have a way to move up and buy their own homes and have a good quality of life. The statute does require...
Can I have everyone's attention, please? I'm the city manager of the city, and I appreciate all the passion folks have, but I must say that everyone in this room, the community has been talking to staff, they've been talking at council meetings. Everyone has said, we want to hear from HCD and ABAG. We want to hear from the folks that are responsible. These folks we have invited, they have very busy schedules. We all have busy schedules. Most of you have busy schedules. It is only respectful to listen to them and allow them to answer your questions. I'm sorry, but it is not respectful, and it is not, see, I'm happy to talk about that issue separate from this. This is on the housing element. And, you know, I don't know what to say. Staff, we have spent hours and days to try and figure out how do we address the concerns of the community, and we're trying to do that. If we have meetings like this and people are just screaming and yelling, then there's no point in having it. I mean, we really should just end it. No, Gail, no thank you. No thank you. There are lots of big questions that we can't hear the answer to. So is there anyone in the room that would like to actually have a question and have someone answer without everyone else yelling?
This one right here. Okay, just one thing. When you're speaking, you have to use the microphone, or the back can't hear you. It says it's on, so sorry. So please use the mic. Speak into
it. Hello, good evening. I understand your frustration. It is understandable. You are here, and the presentation is the same presentations that you've had three or four or five different times. And it's generalized, and there are touchy-feely things that make everybody feel good about their particular position from HCD and from ABAG. But we are actually here to ask some more specific questions, because we have been through a very difficult time, and you probably haven't been told about it. So I just want to fill you in very quickly. You've already heard about some of the experience with the existing low-income housing in Novato. Novato put together a huge project at Hamilton with the renewal of the Hamilton Air Force Base, and I'm sure you're aware of that, right? Mm-hmm. And as a result, ABAC raised our quotas because we had that kind of growth, and we had employment growth. And so we got a same kind of heavy burden after doing this one-time situation with Hamilton Air Force Base. So people feel a little burned from that right at the get-go. And then we are fresh from a year and a half working with a previous group of consultants, which created an inventory, a housing inventory, that was highly concentrated in an older neighborhood of small ranchers and other tract houses, for the most part, in Novato. It was highly concentrated, and we were the victims of your policy of land assembly. And no one ever said, whoops, maybe this wasn't a good idea. But they said over and over again, 30 units per acre. It has to be 30 units per acre. And the developers need more than 1 acre, if possible. And we need to make all of these sites conform to the low-income housing tax credits application with the state. And so when you say that you are not constraining us, when you say that we have local control, with all of these constraints and the additional problems that we're going to be getting from MTC and the two train stations, it's just not genuine. We just simply cannot believe it. Now, if you tell us that you're here to help us work something out in these difficult circumstances, if you tell us that you can, then that would be really wonderful. And I think these good people will cooperate if you will not gloss anything over and if you understand what's happened so far. Do you see? I'm so sorry that it's been difficult. And please move. I'm so sorry it's been difficult. I really am. But please, everyone, give them 5 minutes to say what they want to say, each one of them. Let's go on with the questions. Let's ask the questions carefully. No more yelling. We've been through so many meetings, we can sit through another one. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
There we go.
Yeah, thanks.
I just have one quick question. These properties, are they to be owner-occupied, or will they eventually, through the years, be turned over to Section 8 housing? And then we have another whole big problem on our hands, because we, in Novato, have several units with Section 8 housing, and they're real bad, and the crime rate is very high. And I want to know that if this comes to pass, are they, because I know some places have to be owner-occupied, but if these come down to rentals, then they don't care. They just don't care. And that, I don't think,
okay. Well, the planning process that the housing element involves requires that you plan to accommodate the growth in households by all income levels. It doesn't specify how much has to be for owner. It doesn't specify how much it has to be for renter. But there is an understanding that in every community, there is a need for both rental housing as well as ownership housing. Again, I would tell you that we believe that then if there are issues in rental housing in your community where it is not being maintained, where there are problems with occupants, there are ways to address that, and you should work with the owners to make sure that that happens. I can tell you that the projects that we maintain, we require that they have strict occupancy standards. I can tell you that, you know, most of you, how many of you have, when you moved out of your parents' home, moved immediately into an owner-occupied unit? Well, what cares is that most of us, my son had to move out of my house, and he had to move into an apartment. I was glad that in my community, there was an apartment that he could live in. No, it wasn't Section 8. And again, if there are problems, the housing authority should be operating and taking care of those. And I think you have a very legitimate concern. If you have properties that are not being maintained, that's a problem. That's a problem for those of us who believe we need enough housing, because it does then give you people who have legitimate reasons to want to live next to safe housing, that they should take care of it. You shouldn't have to live next to housing that isn't maintained and that the occupants aren't complying with standards.
Is going now?
I can do mics. Thank you, and I for one appreciate you coming, because I think that it's pretty brave of you to face us. We've been going through this for a long time, and we're cranky, especially if someone tells me I need to now be part of a neighborhood watch for an apartment building that, frankly, I believe should have some sort of penalty attached to them when the police are there every day. So I appreciate your being here. If I were looking at your handouts, which again, they are a version of what we've been seeing since May. The one that talks about the quick facts is partially one of the reasons people here are so upset. We are the ugly stepchild of Marin County, okay? I'm sorry. Most people, I for one, moved here 19 years ago, so I didn't have to work. We chose a house where we could live on one income in Marin County, the most expensive county in the state. Comparing us, throwing us in to a median that has a family of four at $99,000, I think one of our questions to you is, can we be pulled out of that average for Marin County? Because none of the, I mean, there are people here who can't afford to live down in Tiburon, but I'd be in affordable housing down there. I don't want to be. I want to be where I am. But having this be a $99,000 median does not reflect this town. And the allocation we're getting basically is because the rest of the county doesn't have to deal with it. So our allocation is huge, because you have us average with people we don't compare to.
Is that adjustable? She's asking if there's a waiver or.
Well, the income limits are both a function of federal law and state law. So it would require a legislative change to use a different standard. Yeah, it mandates that it is a county.
Hi, my name is Eric von Blankenberg. I'm a general contractor, and I'm struggling right now. I work really hard, and the last thing I want is for someone to pay my bills. The construction industry has a 27% unemployment right now in this state. And so my question to you is, what right do you have to take money out of my pocket that I earned and give it to somebody else for their house? I'm up to my eyeballs in debt. I may have to move out of my house and put my family in an apartment. But I'll be damned if I'm going to ask this community to pay my bills. That's my job.
What I can tell you is that we're not asking you to subsidize anything. The state and redevelopment agencies have resources that can go for subsidies. What you have to do with your housing element is plan for housing that can be affordable to households of all income levels. The statute doesn't make you, state law does not make you subsidize affordable housing, nor does it make the community build it. It makes you plan for it. Well, for example, the most recent resources that our department has came from a general bond obligation that the voters of California approved. So it is your money, but it was voted for by everyone who agreed that providing housing for low-income seniors, for homeless, for mentally disabled people was an appropriate expenditure of their tax dollars.
I'm not speaking for anyone else. You mentioned a bit ago how many of us moved from our parents' house into owner-occupied, and I know certainly in my case that was not true. And then this gentleman got up and spoke about how hard he's working to stay where he is and solidify where he is, do you understand that we're talking a philosophical difference here of being provided for or providing for oneself? And there's a real disconnect in the philosophies from that are coming down to us and that we're going back up.
Can you hear me? Great. My name is Stephen Montoya, and a lifelong resident of Novato. When one part that you folks may not realize, or the legislation isn't realizing, is that yes, we are paying for that subsidized housing? Because we're paying for it through our infrastructure, which is destroyed right now. We are laying off police officers. We are laying off school teachers. Pretty soon, firemen. I mean, we're being told this. We're being asked to pay for more sales tax so the city can stay afloat. When you ask us to come up with a project for high-density, low-income housing, it no longer becomes in the city's control. The fact of the matter is that is controlled by the Marine Ecumenical Center for this county. Is that not correct? We have no local control over any housing plan like this. Okay? We don't, as citizens. Our mayor, our council people, they don't have control. But they're trying to appease you. I just lost the mic. They're trying to appease They've taken millions of dollars from the local cities. This is the poor city in all of Marin. Okay? I work very hard. My wife works very hard. We can't afford to live in another city. We're making it here, barely, but we're making it. Thankfully, we've got retired police officers from San Francisco. This is where they live because they couldn't afford to live in the city. Or if they could, they might be able to live in one of those particular places like you're mentioning. But they're not going to want to do that. They get more bang for their buck up here, which in turn makes our city much safer. Thank you guys for being here. I really appreciate the retired policemen from San Francisco living here. Okay? People are not going to live in Novato and work in Novato making a very small income. If they're making a certain size income, they're going to go for where they can get the bang for their buck. That's bottom line. For us to be trying to... It seems like we're being sold on this type of idea that we have to have low income. Well, Novato is low income, okay? The $90,000 and below, you'd qualify for a $500,000 loan if your credit is good, if you behaved yourself and did what you're supposed to do as an adult, okay? In Novato, we had over 50 units available for people to buy. This was 2 months ago. We have a lot more inventory now because there's a lot more foreclosures. Thank you very much. We have realtors here too. But the other major thing is we need to build these houses. No. Okay? This county is one of the most ecologically friendly counties anywhere. 80% of our land is not for building. It's for everybody to enjoy, not just residents of Marin. I'm a strong believer in reuse. Building new doesn't make sense to me when we've got so many houses that have been foreclosed on. We have so many apartments that are vacant here. This is where people go in Marin County that can't afford to live anyplace else, such as Belvedere, Tiburon. So I apologize for you folks getting bombarded the way you are. It takes a lot of guts to be here. I appreciate you being here, but please understand, this is where we're coming from. And, you know, our city staff and managers have just been pounded because they're trying to make the state mandate, and the residents, they can't see it. They can't see it, and, you know, if you guys can come up with something to help us out with this, that would be great. Jay? Thank you.
Hi. Is this working? About 6 months ago, our city council adopted a vision statement for the revised general plan for this community. And it provided for workforce housing to be spread throughout the community. So this community isn't really against workforce housing per se, nor is it against senior housing. It's for all of those good things. The problem we have is that when the housing element came up next, and I'm on the Planning Commission, the housing element came up next, the staff who is in touch with you folks told us that certain things like we had to have certain kind of massing and certain kinds of density, that those were actually mandated. They also told us, for example, that mixed-use zoning wouldn't count toward our ABAG allocation and that there were regulations about this. And you folks work for us, and you're really here to help us, even though there's a lot of venting going on. And what I'm asking you is to provide us with the kind of assistance that maybe you folks can provide to tell us how we go about spreading workforce housing throughout the community without the kind of massing that has made everybody so angry and so concerned. We don't want to, we want to protect our neighborhoods. We want to preserve their character. The city council is sworn to do that. We on the planning commission are sworn to do that. And we need to find a way interactively in working with the state. How can we spread the allocation, assuming we're stuck with it, because that's the law? How do we spread it around?
One of the questions you brought up, and I saw Melinda shaking her head about no, which may be a communication, is can you use mixed-use housing?
Let me just first say thank you, and I will tell all of you, I appreciate your frustration, and you're more than welcome to express it to us in any way. Our jobs are to come here. We're committed to come here to try to work cooperatively with you to find a solution that meets our obligation is to meet the requirements of state law. But I am committed and convinced that every community in California can do it in a way that is consistent with their vision and your principles for what your community should be. So on the point of, so perhaps we didn't communicate effectively initially with city staff. I can tell you mixed use housing certainly can count towards accommodating the need that you are allocated.
But if you zone it mixed use, what we were told is that if you zone it mixed use, the state staff is not going to count it because they're not convinced that it's actually going to get built.
Well, I can tell you.
That's not
accurate. I can tell you that that is not the case.
Okay, good. Good.
And if you know, if we communicated anything other than that, there was some misunderstanding. You can count. The statute does leave quite a bit of discretion at the local level on how you accommodate that need. Even the dreaded 30 units per acre that you have concerns about, it is not a mandate for 30 units an acre. The statute requires that you identify the zoning that can accommodate and facilitate housing affordable to lower income households, and that usually is done by higher density multifamily housing. Each community has to do an assessment about what density is appropriate for encouraging and facilitating that development. The statute has a 30 unit per acre standard, and there's a variety of them depending on where you are in the state, that says if you have 30 units an acre in your community zoning, you don't have to do an analysis. We will assume that that density is appropriate to accommodate.
That's a safe harbor.
It's a safe harbor. We call it sort of a default density. So any sites that you have that are zoned for that, you can automatically count them towards that housing allocation for lower income. If you do not want to use that density, then you must do, though, an analysis that demonstrates that it is based on market conditions and financial feasibility and the development of housing that's occurred, what density is appropriate. And we can tell you in Marin County, communities have done anything from about 20 units an acre up to about 40 units an acre.
What if we want to do things like second unit housing?
Second units.
What creative ideas? You're doing this statewide. What creative ideas have other communities come up with to avoid having to do 20 to 40, which if you put it in the wrong place, that sounds like a lot in a lot of these neighborhoods. But what kinds of creative ideas do you have?
Well, many communities do like to look into mixed use, because you can put it into a corridor where there's commercial and other uses, there's less impact on surrounding residential neighborhoods. That's where a lot of communities try to accommodate their higher density. So I need to be honest with you. I think it would probably be unreasonable to assume that you could accommodate all of your need without having some housing built at least 20 units per acre. It's generally not going to be financially feasible. But you can have a mix of strategies. So you could have a mix of mixed use along some of your commercial corridors. You could do some second units. You could do You could look into whether or not there are, you know, there are any schools that have want to build housing for teachers, whether the hospital needs employee housing. You can look at sometimes smaller density, compact, like fourplexes, but you put a number of fourplexes on a particular lot, so it doesn't seem to be the massing too much, can provide for, excuse me?
Rental?
Yes, rental housing is generally needed in every community. Yes, yes. And some communities find those more appropriate some communities look at duplexes and fourplexes to get some increased density without having too much of an impact on a particular neighborhood.
So let's say for a minute that we as a community determined or decided that we did not want to meet the statute that you required. There's various ways to meet that. It sounds like 40 units or 20 or some variation. Let's say that we decided that we did not want to meet that. What would the legal and financial repercussions be? And I know that you guys are not the be-all and all, and I know you're probably not lawyers, et cetera, but I presume that you're familiar with other cities who have recently been sued by social advocacy groups and housing groups, such as the Novato Housing Coalition, in the East Bay. So I'm interested in understanding what our legal vulnerabilities may be from those kind of social groups, if you will, and then secondly, what our legal and financial vulnerability may be from the state itself.
Yeah, I'd be happy to. The state does not directly enforce housing element law. So if you have a housing element that is out of compliance, our department is not going to come down and take any legal action against you. If you have an inadequate housing element, it has the potential to render your entire general plan inadequate. And if someone sues you, you could be liable for significant financial penalties in addressing in litigation and leave your community vulnerable. One of the remedies that a court can order if your housing element or your general plan, your whole general plan is inadequate, is they can issue a moratorium on development and not just housing development. Resident commercial development, any building permit in your community. If you want to put in a new sidewalk, if you want to put in a new rehab for your unit, if you want to put in a new driveway, all of that could be stopped. And you have to defend the lawsuit. So it is ultimately, though, it's a community's decision on whether or not they want to comply with the statute. There are resources and benefits for having a housing element in compliance, that those communities who have housing elements in compliance have access to resources that can make it. We have actually a program called a housing-related parks program that you can be rewarded for every housing unit, affordable unit that you permit, with grant dollars that you can use to purchase or rehabilitate local parks.
Go ahead.
All right. Has the state there? Has the state, to your knowledge, taken any of those types of actions against any cities in terms of the moratoriums, or is the threat greater from just litigious social advocacy groups?
The state hasn't taken actions. It's usually private litigation. But I will tell you, the Attorney General's office became a party to an action against the city of Pleasanton over a growth limitation that they had. So I don't want to say that somebody in the state couldn't take some action. I can tell you our department doesn't have any enforcement arms. We have been trying to use rewards and benefits to recognize communities that are that are taking the hard work and trying to get housing built, trying to provide additional resources.
I just want to... I just want to know if people understand what 1 acre is. It's approximately 200 feet square, and you're putting 30 units an acre, you're going to end up with a house about 20 foot square.
One of the most thriving businesses right now in California are businesses that relocate California companies to other states. And California tops the list for its regulatory hassle index. I thought that was very interesting, according to calwatchdog.com. So I think the woman's point over there about the philosophical difference is that, you know, big government is scaring people, and it's really alarming. My questions are specifically for NGO, ABAG. And you're an NGO, right?
No, we're the Council of Governments for the Bay Area. We're,
but you're a non-government organization, technically?
We're an organization of the 101 cities and 9 counties of the Bay Area.
Okay, can you explain? I was on your website. I was looking up the projections 2009. That was,
yes.
I thought, really interesting. Can you explain ABAG's concept about social and economic equity? And
sure.
Define that. Thank you.
Social and our concept about social and economic equity. It's a little general. It's my website. You're right. Okay. Social and economic equity would be, in this case, for example, providing housing for all the different income levels in the community. Is that what you're trying to get at, or is there something more specific you're asking?
Okay. This is on the, there's so much paperwork with this, I'm trying to keep an eye on you guys sometimes. Seriously.
That's why we come here.
Pardon?
And that's why we come here.
Okay, and I appreciate that. Okay, so on the projections 2009, that main page, there's something called performance targets.
Sure.
Okay, and it talks about for congestion, trying to reduce the amount of time basically in cars,
right.
The vehicle miles traveled by, you have certain performance standards, like you want to reduce that by 10% by 2035. And then there's this thing called the equity, affordability, and access. It says you want to increase the non-automobile dependent access to jobs and essential services by 20% compared
right.
to today by 2035. See, to many of us, that sort of sounds like, you know, France, or very, you know, really compact, tight. You know, it doesn't sound very attractive. I mean, if I wanted to live in Emeryville or Berkeley,
right.
I'd live there.
Right. And the value of that is when you look at a regional measure, when you're trying to do planning at a regional level, you're not trying to say that every community has to have the same standards. Every community has to look like each other. Equity issues in San Francisco are going to be different than the equity issues in a smaller community that doesn't have transit. So if more of the growth is in a place like San Francisco or in Oakland or a San Jose, where there's access to transit, where people can actually get to jobs, where they can do their business without having so much car travel, then that's going to be beneficial to the entire region. It's not to say that every person has to do that, that everyone has to move closer to transit or use less car travel. But in aggregate, if you have people with more opportunities to access transit, that means the investments the community has put into a BART system, a Caltrain, light rail in San Jose or San Francisco, you're actually getting the benefits out of the investment you put into that transit. Similarly, everybody else, better air quality, addresses these greenhouse gas issues. So it's a broader sort of measure and goal.
Thank you. Over here, and then let's get a microphone over to her in yellow.
Thank you. I personally don't want high density housing. Whether it's low income, whether it's high income, I don't want it. It doesn't fit with our community. And I'm for affordable housing. I'm fine with that. That's why I moved to Novato, because it was affordable for me 19 years ago. But what I'm looking for is a distributed and integrated approach, and one that's subject to local control. If we choose to build something as a community, then we would like to build what we want, where we want, when we want. What surprised me was that I was told we have many available properties currently, as Steve mentioned. I was told that those don't count towards our low-income allocation, that what we have to do is we have to build new units. So why is it, I don't know if I'm the only one, I'm guessing I'm not, feeling put upon by outsiders, somebody in Sacramento telling us, you and Novato need to do this because we think it's right. We want to control it. So why do we have to build anything new?
Well, maybe I shouldn't be speaking for the state, but at the same time, when you're talking about this housing needs allocation, it's a planning process, so it's putting capacity in the housing element for future growth. There's not a requirement that a project gets built to satisfy that. The requirement really is that there's a good faith effort by the community to have this planning done in the housing element of their general plan. It's certified by the state, but I mean, people point out that in a market like this, it could well be the case that private developers aren't taking the community up on those opportunities anytime in the near future. If there is plenty of housing available now, most developers aren't going to run out and say, okay, look, there's Novato and they put more capacity in the housing element of their general plan, let's go build that project. They're going to look at the economics of that project. They're going to decide, does that make sense? And as a result, it may not be the case that communities here or other places actually take all of that capacity during the period that we're this planning period that we're talking about.
So we don't actually have to. We don't have to build, but we have to allocate for building. Even if we don't want to, we're still forced to make that allocation.
The statute, state law, does require that you plan to accommodate the growth that is expected to occur in your community. So, yeah, it does require that you plan and you have zoning that would accommodate it. He's exactly right, though. You are not. There's an acknowledgement in the statute that local governments don't build housing. You aren't required, you don't have a quota for the number of units you have to build. You have a quota for the number of units you have to plan for and provide the opportunity for. So, and I will just address the issue, in part the issue about existing housing stock not counting. Two things I want to just mention on that. One is that when ABAG, and when you're looking at the amount of growth that's expected to occur in your community based on the number of people who are actually being born in the community as a component of it, they look at how much housing you currently have in your community. So much of the housing that you already have is already factored into, then you need that much more growth or housing to accommodate the growth. But I will also tell you there is a provision in the law that allows you to count up to 25% of your RENA allocation, your allocation, for existing units if you can show that they're going to be currently non-affordable units that you want to maybe put some rehabilitation. You have a redevelopment agency and you have a unit that's substandard, it's not in good condition, and if you can make that unit affordable, up to 25% of the allocation can be met with that existing housing stock.
Just a follow-up.
Hi, my name is Jeannie. I live in Novato.
I have a little bit of a philosophical issue with SB 375. That's the authorizing legislation that makes it so you have to be here to enforce those allocations, correct? SB 375 is a green initiative, correct? It's about air
but
quality?
SB 375 was passed in 2008, and the housing element law and the requirements that we're talking about tonight have been in effect since about 1969, but as you know it about, as the statute is now, since about 1980. SB 375 more predominantly addresses transportation planning, although it does make some, it made some amendments to housing element law.
Correct.
But it is predominantly a transportation planning.
Right. And that's my point. Okay. Since it is a transportation issue, and the idea of it is to get the greenhouse gas off the freeway, I'd like to know who decided that there are millions of people streaming into Novato. I've never been caught in gridlock going north on 101. So if the idea is that all of these baristas and clerks and people need to live where they work, I don't understand who decided that they're all streaming in from elsewhere to work here when the traffic is in fact going south, not north. I just don't understand why, if the traffic is going south and people are not streaming in here to work, why we have to put them in the middle of residential neighborhoods and just move the greenhouse gases from the freeway into the middle of our neighborhoods. It doesn't make sense to me.
As Cathy was saying, this statute, SB 375, this greenhouse gas initiative, has an effect on housing element law. At the same time, housing element law, there's large portions of it that are completely unchanged by that. And that law is what's motivating the idea of a requirement for the region to have a total housing need, for this assignment of that housing need to all the different communities in the region. I don't think that this SB 375 law really makes a profound difference in the way or the numbers that you might see from the housing elements or from this regional housing needs allocation process.
You, sir.
As a number of my community members have expressed that they are really feeling put upon by the government, the state government, enforcing these allocations down our throat. I have a real basic, simple question. Exactly what articles of the federal and state constitution allow the government to dictate to communities what housing and types of housing they can build based on income? Real simple question.
I don't think that there's a constitutional requirement for what you can and cannot build.
Permission. Where did we give you permission to tell us who to have as neighbors and how many houses to build?
State law.
Wait, I'm sorry. You were presiding over an unconstitutional government entity. It's just that simple.
Okay.
State and city of it.
And you can't answer a basic.
I'm not representing anybody. Question. I'm not representing anybody. Thank you.
Okay.
Can we get an answer to that? Someone tell us when we'll get that answer. Because that's exactly what I'm here for, and now you find out. Where did we, the people, give you, the government, not you specifically?
Thanks.
Permission. I'm speaking loud, but I don't have a microphone. Give you the permission that this gentleman is asking.
Where did we give you permission to tell us who and how and what lives in our town? I live here for the same reason that I moved here for the same reason a lot of other people. And I, you know what, I'm nervous, sorry. I'm mad as hell too though. And I got an argument for almost everything you've said, okay?
Okay.
But mostly I want to know, where did we give you permission? Because that's what this comes down to for me.
You know,
for me, that's the first and last question.
You know, I saw this. Well, and I'll apologize, because when I saw the state law that said that there was a requirement to do regional planning for housing, I didn't look any further to see what its constitutional basis was. I'm not either. I didn't bring one.
If your lawyer asks,
there has to be a constitutional lawyer.
Are you?
That's what we need.
The state representative is voting for these laws. And if you want to change the laws, you've got to change the state representative.
So make sure you go out and vote on in November. Okay. The state is telling us that we have to conserve water. The water department is telling us we have to conserve water. So if you're a state entity, why aren't you listening to the state telling you that? And how can you tell us we have to have more and more housing? I would like to see the paper that has the facts of how you accommodated, how many units we'd have to build here, split up among high, low, medium, low, low, and all everything like that. I would like to know how long you both worked for government, if you'd only ever worked for the government in your life, what your salaries are, and how much it's costing us to have you here tonight. what the main thing of the whole thing is, why can't we be a suburban instead of urban, which is one of the things where we get lower? If the 30 units per acre is for Novato, and that's only 20 units per acre over the line up the street for Sonoma. When we have so much open space, I don't get how we're so well built out. I doubt if we'll have many businesses moving in here to have more help to have to put housing in because of the way the economy is. So what is the real basis for you figuring out how much housing has to be where, and how can we change it? I read Dave Wallace's letter to ABAG from 2007, mm-hmm. has a lot of good points in it, mm-hmm. and the thing that really got me is it talked about how HCD tells ABAG how many units. So who tells HCD, and can we fire you?
Well, you know, when we talk about the number of units, there's a requirement. It is something that's calculated. There's no doubt about it. It's something, you know, it's based on a lot of statistical data about the population.
Who sets the formula?
I think the formula is really, I guess it comes from the State Department of Finance. They have a demographic unit that identifies a lot of the population data in terms of.
Is that your knowledge, right? Well, Melinda, that it's set at the.
It's right. Based on a demographic projections that are used. Sorry, it's based on standard demographic calculations on population growth that have been used for the last 30 years and have been proven to be pretty accurate. It is based at least in part on looking at the number of people who are born in a community, the number of people that have died. It looks at the age of the population, because you can figure out based on that, you can make some assumptions about how they form households, whether they're going to need new housing. But it is based on standard scientific demographic data about the population growth. So it is focused on looking at how many people are expected to be in your community over a period of time. Yes. But then the allocation gets put down to each individual city based on a variety of factors.
Thank you.
The demographics? It's been since at least the 1950s that I'm aware of.
All right. I'll try it again.
Thank you. Yes.
Actually, I have a question. When I came here tonight, I was all excited about the 3 pages of questions, and I realized you didn't get to give your presentation, but I looked at the packet, and it didn't seem as if your packet addressed the questions that were here, and certainly ABAG's little sheet didn't address the questions that were here. Is there any play or any way that you can specifically answer the questions in writing and have them posted somewhere where we can go and see the answers in writing to all of the questions that we've had in the past?
That's a great idea. I mean, is that something that...
You have the specific questions here, and you should have the resources to answer them for us. And we should have a central place where we can go to get them.
The city has made a commitment that they were going to post it on the website, all the questions that came up and the answers that could be answered.
Okay.
So I'm, you know. Okay, Paul and Kathy, you think it's possible as well from you?
3 pages.
It's a lot.
We will do our best to. That's why we came here tonight, okay, to provide answers, and we'll do our best to get you the information.
Thank you.
In writing.
One of the gentlemen over here asked who's cramming this stuff down our throat. Before I came to the meeting tonight, I called up our local representative, Senator Leno, and asked his office what his viewpoint was on affordable housing in Novato, as a majority of the Novatoans do not want affordable housing. The lady that answered the phone, or the high density, the lady on the phone stated that the senator was strongly in favor of that. And you want to know who's cramming it down your throat? Look in the mirror. You vote for Leno. He's in office. The other thing is that Huffman's office, I called his office and asked him what his viewpoints were on the affordable high-density housing. His office didn't have an opinion, which means he's running for election. You're marking him on your ballot. What do you think he would do if he got 100 phone calls tomorrow from everybody in this audience telling him that you don't like the law? So you vote these people in, and then you reap what you sow. So, you know, Leno's for it and Huffman, who won't commit. So pick up the phone and ask.
Eleanor Sluice, and I've been here since 1992. And I moved here because of the weather. I'm a retired teacher. And I taught, my husband and I lived in LA, and I taught in the ghetto areas. Then later on, I have taught in ghetto areas, actually up in Northern California, where we brought our children up. Then moving down here, I taught in Oakland, and I've taught in Richmond even 11 years. And because I was also renting years, 50 years ago in Berkeley. So in 50 years and in Palo Alto, we used to live. So seeing the progression of the growth as a teacher and seeing the low income housing come into Oakland and into Richmond and now El Cerrito, it doesn't work because it impacts the schools. It impacts our infrastructure, and we don't have the money to pay for it. So there's the disconnect. It's the infrastructure, as somebody said. My question then is, how can we slow the process? Do we have to have this done in like timely manner? Can we take another year to really look at this? Because I think the data is wrong.
Well, there is a statutory deadline, which was 2009, so you've already missed that. So you most communities are going to take the time that you think is necessary. And if there's, you know, if you feel that there is a risk, you know, you might feel that it's, you feel that it's better to take the time that you need. It's a decision that the community will make about the pace of time that you're going to use to get it done. Can you please repeat it? What was your...
Good evening.
Which
So your question was, can There is no provision. The numbers have been allocated. You need to plan for them now. There was a process for appeals in the regional housing needs processes. Communities do have the opportunity to appeal the allocation. Once they've been finalized, though, the statute does not provide for a reduction or a change in the number. For this period, yes.
Hi. I also would like to thank you for coming. And in a prior life, I had a position of being in meetings like you are, and it's uncomfortable. Even though it's not personal, it's still uncomfortable. Thank you very much. One thing I haven't heard this evening, just until just now, is about the schools. We have a 10-year-old at Lou Sutton. And 2 years ago, Lou Sutton was a distinguished school. This year, they can't even hit 800 as a school. Now, we passed, as Novatoans, we passed a parcel tax last year, which was to fill a gap that the states took from us of in excess of $4 million. So this parcel tax now is based on all of the property owners in town. The senior citizens that are on fixed incomes can be exempt from that tax if they choose to. So in the next few years, when this housing starts coming in here, there will be more people that are going to become exempt from this tax, more kids coming into the schools. And I guess the question is, are these people that are coming in here going to have to pay or help participate in their community and pay their portion of the parcel tax in order to help us maintain the schools we moved here to be in? Because right now, if it's a little over four million, it's supposed proposed almost 6 million, I think, in 3 more years or something when this parcel tax ends. Are the people that are be developing these properties, is that part of their tax benefits not to have to participate in the parcel tax? Because what happens then, obviously, schools become more crowded. We have less facilities. Teachers are not able to spend more time with kids. I mean, it's the thing that's been going on now for a while.
Well, the development community pays a school tax. So when they develop housing, there is a fee that they have to pay for schools in order to develop. And that money is supposed to be used to help develop or improve new schools or improve the existing schools. So the development community does pay fees to help compensate for schools. That is correct. Well, many of the school fees go to pay, many builders actually pay for new schools in a number of communities. Well, so the issue is you have a very legitimate concern about the quality of schools in your community. That is absolutely a legitimate concern. Anybody who has children wants to make sure that the schools that their children are going to go to are good quality schools and they're going to have a good chance to go on and be successful in life. Accommodating the growth that's coming in your community, whether or not you plan for housing or not, people are coming in your community. In the 1990s, when there was a significant decline in the amount of housing that was built, the population in California grew, and the way that got accommodated was by people overcrowding, many families living in an existing unit. The reality is, California has been growing by about 450,000 people to 500,000 every year for the last 20 to 50 years. So the idea is that we try to plan to accommodate that growth in a way that minimizes the impact on your community, that if you plan for it, you can actually make sure that it does accommodate the water needs. Housing being built now, it has to be 20% more water efficient than it was before. If you build more compact development, you can use water more efficiently. So there are a variety of needs that have to be met in the community, and housing is one of them, but a quality education and good schools is an important issue that you should be addressing.
Is there any chance that we could add that to the list of the questions that we'll give you a written answer to? Because I have to tell you, I'm not familiar enough with the parcel tax to know.
The answer is
Section 8 housing for the record. There is no more new certificates for Section 8 housing. I will tell you that housing, certain housing that is affordable under certain ways is exempt for a period of time from certain property taxes. That's part of the benefit of developing, trying to provide other public value. So I don't know how it relates to the parcel specific tax. It may not be exempt from that.
Hi. My question is regarding to the data. I think a lot of us feel that the data that these decisions was based on is flawed. And with regards to the growth that's happened in California consistently over the last 20 years, I think it's fair to say that the economic climate right now is very different. Our housing values are falling through the floor. Many of us have seen 40% loss in our property values. Novato is much more highly affected than any other town in Marin County in this respect. So if you don't consider the 96 homes that are available under $500,000 in Novato, and that number is growing, what, it was 50, he said, in May, and the foreclosure epidemic sees no halt, how can you base these projections on a condition that does not no longer exist?
You're right, things have changed quite a bit. When we did the forecast that this allocation was based on, it was probably in 2006. That's right. And when we talked about these numbers, we used them for assigning a total number between all the different communities in the Bay Area. So one thing when you talk about this is that the recession has affected communities across the Bay Area, across the country, across the world. The numbers are used for assigning this total by these income categories across the different communities in the Bay Area. So the number, this housing need we were talking about a few years ago, 214,500 units in total. 214,500 units. So San Jose got 34,000 units and some change. San Francisco got 30,000 units. Oakland got 14,000 units, on and on and on. All the different communities got market rate housing, moderate affordable housing. So as the numbers change for the allocation, it's not necessarily easy to say that that means that your community should have gotten a lower share of that versus some other community in the Bay Area.
Those formulas would be reevaluated, or anybody would look at that, any plans to through and say, take into account, here's what's happening right. For the economy, here's what's happening for
right. For this process, when the regional housing needs allocation is done and certified, which it occurred some years ago, it isn't revised after that point. There isn't a provision for revising those numbers. Right. Well, Because the economic reality, again, the fellow's question over there, when you're planning for these different categories of housing and the housing element, there isn't a requirement for the city to build that housing. So if the economic reality is that there's available housing on the market, what happens is that a private developer isn't necessarily going to take up the investment of building new housing, recognizing that there are, as if you say, 96 housing units available on the market now. The plans are in place. If market conditions change, then certainly they would think about that. But it seems a little difficult to reconcile that the plans turn into development projects in any near time frame if there's a kind of a backlog of housing right now. Can what be amended?
Yeah.
No.
Am I ready?
Yeah. I wasn't going to speak tonight because I spoke at the meeting in June at City Hall in August here. And mainly I spoke because I've had 46 and a half years in law enforcement. I retired. And I'll tell you, when I worked in San Francisco, where you have affordable housing, low-cost housing, or whatever label you want to put on it, you're going to have a high rate of crime. You know, it's inevitable. You're going to have drugs, you're going to have gangs, you're going to have crime. So I'm not going to get into that because I'll be only repeating myself. You people weren't here when I spoke about that. I went into depth on that. But when we first started, one gentleman over here stated that he didn't want to go through this list here. And because some of these things aren't really accurate. And if you give any more meetings somewhere else, I think I ought to change a lot of these things. One of them on page 4, and you're talking about crime, it's the last one down there. It says popular misconceptions about affordable housing. And it says high density and affordable housing increases crime. And you put down fact. Design and use of space has a far more significant effect on crime than density or income levels. Well, I beg to differ with you. I think you should change that around and reverse it and put density and income levels has a far more significant effect on crime. Because I've seen that in San Francisco in the public housing projects. And the other thing you got on the top of this list on the same page, it says affordable housing reduces property values. Well, I beg to differ with you there. I think everybody here in this room worked their way up to Novato. We all worked hard. We made good decisions. We got an education. And we decided to buy a home and settle in Novato and raise our children because it was a safe community. You had good churches and had good schools. But I think we're seeing this changing now. The other thing is, I believe that 95% of the people in this room definitely do not want high density housing. You know, we've already all, like another lady just mentioned, took a big hit on our property values because of the subprime mortgage issue. And that was the government stuck their hands in that with Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac and wanted to change all the issues about getting a home so housing could be affordable to everybody, you know, but some people just can't afford it. And I just think that a lot of us in this room here are getting tired of the federal and the state government making mandates upon us. And maybe, like the other man said, when we go to vote, maybe we can change some of that in November. The other thing is, I want to know if you've made any effort to put affordable housing where the politicians live, Boxer and the rest of those people, and see how they like it, you know. I know I've heard from, and other people have, some of the police officers here in Novato, that when you built your affordable housing over in Hamilton Air Force Base, they now refer to those housing developments, and they call them Marin City North, you know, and we don't want to spread. Okay. You know, like I say, we've all worked hard up here to live in a good community and buy our homes. And now you want to take low income population that have a lot of issues and a lot of problems and transport them or transplant them into Novato. And that's going to have a lot of effect on our community as far as crime. And the other lady, I'm glad late she brought up the issues about our schools. You know, we're impacted in our schools. We have not enough money, you know, to pay the teachers, and our budgets have a lot of problems. So that's about it.
Thanks. I asked a question at the last meeting of the city. The point was made that if a property is identified and it's zoned high density, and an applicant comes in, developer comes in with a project that matches that zoning, then the city cannot deny that project. That was a statement made during the presentation. The question I had was then, if a developer or an applicant comes in and submits a project that is lower than the approved density and not affordable, does the city have to deny it?
for you, right?
I believe it's.
No?
It is a city issue, but I'm happy to take it on. The by right, I think what you're referring to, by right requirements, when you are zoning, the community has a variety of sites in your community zoned at a certain density, and state law requires that you have zoning for a variety of housing types that could accommodate a variety of income levels. And it doesn't directly affect your approval of that. If you haven't been able to identify sufficient sites to accommodate your need, and you have to rezone sites to provide for those sites have to be by right. That would ensure that if a project developer, if you've already zoned the land, and the project developer comes in and is providing housing that is consistent with your own zoning ordinance, then it must be approved. It is allowed to have design review standards, and not all sites have to be that way. And I want to clarify as well, the statute doesn't mandate, nor does it require, that you zone for income level or zone for affordable housing. You're zoning and have your zoning is controlling the density of the land, but doesn't mandate that you put an affordable housing or a subsidized housing project there. It requires that you provide the opportunity for that development. Does that answer? Okay, I'm sorry, what didn't? Well, it depends on what your city's zoning code is and what the if it has a minimum density standard, and if it doesn't, the city, unless it is a site that got rezoned, those sites have to have minimum densities. But for the rest of the land in your community, it is what your existing zoning allows. Only if it is a site that had to be rezoned. So if you went in your community right now and looked at your existing zoning and you said, we have enough zoning to accommodate the need, then there is no specific state mandate on minimum densities. So for the sites that you do have to rezone, those do have to have a minimum density. No, it is not 30 units per acre. The statute specifically says if you have to have a rezoning program to accommodate some of your need, there is a minimum density for those rezoned sites and only those of 20 units an acre. No, it is not. So I tried to clarify that earlier. There is no, the 30 unit standard that you're talking about is like a safe harbor requirement. There is no mandate in state law that you have to provide housing at a minimum of 30 units an acre. If I can clarify anything at all tonight, I would like to try to do that. Honestly, I'm telling you, there is no mandate at 30 units an acre. There is, for only those sites, if you do have to do some rezoning. Yes, there is. Well, that's not, wasn't my understanding that was the case.
Just a layman, but to me, all these sites need to be rezoned up to 20 or 30, okay? So if you're answering this question,
you have to build that. No, well, first of all, you don't have to build. You have to provide the opportunity. And I believe that your community has sites that are currently zoned at about 20 units an acre that you would be able to accommodate some portion of your need for. So I mean, that's an issue for your planning department, but.
Thank you. I think we're here tonight sort of like a small animal in a trap. I think a lot of the history that has been given tonight is not quite the real history. Sure, the government's been in the business of providing housing for a long, long time, But there's been a tremendous change in the housing law, particularly 2004, and then, of course, 2008. Even though it is MTC and transportation law, is going to affect Novato's housing, particularly because we have two stations already. So we are only talking about this cycle, and so this cycle is different from the next, but the next will involve a transportation component, for sure. Now, the reason we're an animal in a trap is because ABAG is a very, very powerful regional government. And every year that goes by, it becomes more powerful. It manages millions of dollars of financing. It has a coordinated program now for putting the airborne resources and the transportation and the housing all together. So you're a very, very powerful agency. And you are dominated by the cities in the Bay Area. ABAG is different from many of the other COGs because of your executive board, the way the membership is allocated according to population. So the point is, Marin is just a little tiny figure, small animal in this calculation. And our voice can hardly be heard. And Novato is an even smaller animal in Marin. We don't share very many of the characteristics of San Francisco or Oakland. So we're caught in this larger picture. And yes, we are going to have to do what you tell us to do. And whether it's because you put penalties on it, or whether it's because Marin Community Foundation bankrolls a variety of advocacy groups, and they in turn sue us, we're going to have to do this some way or another, okay? And it's going to be because of these agencies coming from the outside to the inside. And if Novato is a house, then the state, ABAG, even Marin County, has taken our house, and they have taken all the locks off. And they have taken these locks off, and they've said, okay, the doors are not locked. There is no barrier. There's no fence. There's no latch. You can walk on in, because ABAG has an aim for social equity to create a median distribution of housing. There's a median for all of these various levels, the extremely low, the moderate, the above moderate. And the idea is that every place in the whole Bay Area should approximate that median distribution of housing. Never mind that Marin County has had a growth rate of 1.4 for the last 10 years, compared to the state of California having a growth rate of about 8 or 9%. You're never mind that we're very, very different. We're going to make this medium distribution all the way around. That's your idea of social equity. And furthermore, you have a rule of 175%. You have the 175% rule, so that any jurisdiction that whose housing is below this level gets penalized, 75%. You have to have a factor of 175% instead of 100%. And I've read through the documents where every time there's a housing cycle, you duke it out in terms of the formulas, and you don't even tell people the formulas. Because what? Because they're obscure? Because they're based on projections that only you guys know about and nobody else gets to see? Nobody gets to criticize your numbers. Nobody gets to criticize your numbers. We can't even get the raw numbers for Novato. Our people fought to get the allocation lowered, and they did it. They did it, but we can't find the raw numbers. We can't.
So he said, Paul says that we didn't have the raw numbers for Novato.
So, you know, when you're asked, what are the formulas? How do you do it? And so on. We're not eighth graders. We can actually figure that out. So I would really like to have the raw data.
Pam, thank you. There's other people in the back that really want to speak.
Who has not spoken yet? Raise your hand. Okay, so we have one over there. This gentleman. And this woman left, unfortunately. I didn't get to her quick enough. So go ahead, sir.
Hello. Just speaking, I think for me this meeting went sour. The first slide I saw up there was for workforce housing. Speaking from experience, I think it was 2003 or 2004, I worked for a public agency here in Novato. Both my wife and I were working at the time. We don't have any children. We applied for the workforce housing at Hamilton, and we were going to go ahead and do it. We were denied because we made too much money, which I think was just a touch under $90,000 a year for both of our incomes. So to me, workforce housing is kind of like this fluff piece that allows this other entity to move into this. As the gentleman talked to me behind me, the Marin City North of Hamilton, thank God we didn't get in that because it's a mess. So I have actually two questions, a two-parted question for you, and I have a question for someone in the city that can answer for me either directly or talk to me later. When you start one of these projects, these low-income, high-density projects, what's the percentage of actual workforce housing that goes into these projects that work in the community, even if it's outside the community, within 5-10 miles? And owner occupancy of these workforce projects, what's the percentage of the workforce, the percentage of the owners of these workforce projects? And if there's a statistic, after 5 to 10 years, how many of these are still owned by people who work in the community as so-called workforce housing? And my third question is that you brought up a good point about, you know, if there's a project in your city that's not doing very well and it's a problem, take care of it. I'd like to know who owns the apartment building at Diablo and Center. Yeah, it's a mess. It's a crime zone. I'm sick of reading about it. I'm sick about driving it to it every through it every morning. And if you can answer those questions, the percentage of the people who actually buy these units and are workforce housing and stay in them over a number of years, and after those number of years, if they're still owner occupied or rentals. Because
I don't know about the particular projects in your community. Any projects, for example, that our department has provided either grants or loans for are mandated to stay affordable for a specified period of time. So if we've provided a mortgage assistance to a particular home, it may be required to stay affordable for a specific period of time. When we do rental units, they are mandated to stay affordable for 55 years. If they got assistance in them and they were affordable home ownership units, they have to stay as home ownership units. I can't speak to the specific projects that you're speaking about. And with regard to I can tell you that projects that we put money into, we monitor for a period of time. So again, we have projects that we've done for 55 years and can. For 55 years for rental units, and it depends on the assistance. The home ownership programs vary from 10 years to maybe 30 years. So it depends on the program. But where most of the time, if a public agency has put public resources into an affordable project, they have a way to maintain sorry, maintain the integrity of those projects and the public investment for a period of time. So I can't speak to who occupies them in terms of whether they're Novato residents or not. I don't know if that information is available. We could look at it. But they do have to be maintained as affordable for whatever the particular loan or grant program specified. If it's a privately subsidized project, you're right, there isn't any, I think, local regulation that would mandate that they stay as affordable or that stay as a home ownership unit. If there's public subsidies in them and they got home ownership dollars, they would have to. I'm sorry, can you repeat? I couldn't understand.
What will be the composition of the individuals who receive these low
Most, I can speak to the programs that our department administers. So we have a multifamily rental program that provides assistance to develop affordable rental housing. Though that program requires that a certain income level, and it can be anywhere from 35% of the area median income up to 60%, but it's only based on income. It doesn't require any other kind of criteria. Now, there are other funding programs that are designed, for example, exclusively to assist elderly or senior housing, and that housing, if it was assisted, would have to be maintained as affordable and occupied by senior households.
Thank you. Back here, Red.
Come on. Hello. Hi, my name is Dave Jones. I grew up in this community. I'm also a police officer here. I've been here for 8 years as a cop, and I'm here to tell you, I lived in Hamilton, and I don't know any cop that should or would want to live in that neighborhood. I married a gal that lived there, and I moved out as quickly as I could because I knew the crime rate was astronomical. And they paint this big, beautiful picture that they maintain this property. They may maintain the property outside, the grounds. Maybe they pick up the trash every once in a while. But it's the cops that are picking up the true traps in the neighborhood, and it's all the low-income housing in that neighborhood. There was a number of teachers that were great, lived in the area, but the surrounding were all my customers and all my clients. And I'm here to tell you, it's not a place that any cop, teacher, firefighter, janitor wants to live if they grew up in this community. To see what they did to Hamilton over there, where my granddad served in the military, turn it into some low-income housing where there's drugs, there's crack pipes in the street. I have a 5-year-old daughter that used to go walking around the neighborhood. So I want to know what you guys are going to do to maintain the crime levels in there. If they have to just do a one little time pay to help out the schools, what about the increasing crime rates and the firefighters and cops that are getting fired? How are those guys going to pay for my wages? Because I'm going to have to pick up my work now when all these low-income housings come in this nice community.
Good evening.
I cannot speak to the specific circumstances that you're talking about in Hamilton, because I don't know that community. I'm sorry, but I can tell you, I don't know every housing project in your community. I'm sorry. But I can tell you that I believe and you will, I am going to get a boo for this, but it is a misnomer that just because you have a low income that you are more likely to have crime in your house. It is an absolute misnomer. Again, I'd like to ask how many of you started out with your communities making $75,000. So your children are low income. Because they have a low income, you think that they're automatically going to be a crime? It is a really unfortunate thing that you would equate income to crime.
There's going to be crime. I'm stating a specific place that I lived that was low income, that was inundated with crime. And to compare us to an 18-year-old that just moved out of our parents' house is an insulting to our intelligence. We all worked our butts off to get where we were step by step. Nobody handed us anything. I never walked out and said, here's my hand, where's my free stuff? I served my country in the Marine Corps, and I'm serving it in this community right now. And I'll be damned if I'm going to sit here and have my hand out and just say, where's all my free stuff? These people have every right to live here, right? But they have to earn it.
Everybody has experience, their own experience, in their own community. We want to honor everybody's experience, her experience from Sacramento, Hall's experience, city managers, but she can't know everything. I heard someone say, she can't. Okay.
All right.
So let's get back to where we were going to go with this. You had a comment, sir?
Good evening, David Wilner. I have to say, sitting here and listening to the comments, that it's been very educational for me. As a rule, when there's a controversy, there's also an exchange of information and knowledge. And something crossed my mind as everybody was talking, and I could feel the energy flowing toward ABAG and toward the officials from the state of California, and I share everybody's frustration, but I think you're missing the boat. The information that I got tonight, if the lady is correct, and I believe she is, ABAG is not going to sue Novato if we don't comply with high-density housing requirements. Keep that in mind. What she told us, and what I believe to be true, and what I've told the city council, is it's going to be the nonprofit high-density affordable housing groups that are going to sue us. Now, think about this for a moment. I did an investigation, and I can tell you for a fact that members of our city council, members of our planning commission, and the Novato Board of Supervisors have made donations to these organizations. Think about that for a minute and direct some of your energy there. Let's not have city officials that are supposed to be representing us donating money to organizations that are going to sue us if we don't comply with state law. Thank you.
Yeah, hey, this is Anya. Yeah. So I think there's my experience has been that there's a lot of frustration probably with both sides, both of our city representatives as well as with the outside agencies for kind of some, I don't know, want to say poor communication, but certainly miscommunication, and people were uninformed as to what the process was going to be, what the timeline was. I think there's still some confusion there. I know I have a couple comments, really. One's a follow-up on a woman that made it one earlier, which is, what, you know, how can we move forward when there, we know there's been material change both in income levels, housing prices, growth rate assumptions, which appear to be wrong? How do you move forward with that when those numbers are seem to be clearly wrong?
Well, you know, this is a process that's gone on for a number of years already. It is one that has been certified, and there really isn't any opportunity to change the numbers at this point for this cycle. Right.
Be the only one that would move forward in a situation when there's been a material change.
What happens is that these numbers are revised periodically. There's going to be a new process starting probably next year. Okay. It'll be a process that will take a couple of years to go through this cycle because that's the legal requirement. Basically, in terms of appeals. And
the growth rate question, I mean, just that alone, how do you, when there's never been a growth rate of 5% in Marin County nor Novato over the last 20 years,
right?
How can you apply that number if you just look at that and say, well, just that number alone is flawed?
Right. So the number for the allocation, that's not an allocation for a single year, right? You understand that's
yes.
A number for a period of time.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Our growth rate is below probably any county in the entire state.
Right.
And second question is really for the city council. I think it's just overall, what is our current stock of affordable housing? What is our current stock of apartments and non-owner occupied rental units? I mean, it seems the low to mid-level housing in this town in the last 2 years has turned over. Now it once was owner occupied. Those owners are moving out and now is going to be lower rental units, which will be available. I mean, look on Craigslist. There's stuff everywhere. I don't see how you can't reassess that inventory as qualifying for this.
Just there is information on our website, and if it isn't, staff's collecting questions, and we'll add
I
that
think
to
if you
FAQs.
Took a poll here, how many apartment units are in Novato?
I can't tell you the number at the top, but I'm sure we have the information can tell you. So I want to go back to some other neighbors who are awaiting this gentleman right back here.
My question for you is, you had said that developers don't have to develop. Right now, the development environment is nobody's developing because they can't reach their pro formas. What I'd like to know is what grants, loans, tax breaks, subsidies, et cetera, do you grant the low-income housing groups or the developers who want to come in and develop these? And wouldn't that make your pro forma more attractive if you had those?
Certainly, somebody's investment would be more attractive if there were some sort of subsidies. We don't, as an organization, grant subsidies to people. There are state and federal programs out there for bond financing, for tax increment sort of financing. Generally speaking, when a developer puts a project together that includes affordable housing components, it's pretty specific to the project, and so it's difficult for me to just sort of give you a blanket answer for that. They typically are putting a number of different funding sources together. I can't really answer.
But doesn't
that
make it more attractive?
Yes, and if you were, there are a number of agencies, both, you know, you have a redevelopment agency that has resources. Our department has a variety of programs that can provide low interest financing for both the development of ownership housing as well as rental housing. We have a website. I'd be happy to get you the information. There are a couple of other state agencies. There's federal agencies that can provide funding both for the development of housing as well as for infrastructure that is needed to help support the development of that housing or other public local needs in the community. There are resources out there that can help make that kind of development more attractive, and I'm happy to get that information to your city or to you directly.
But there, typically, the people, the developers who want to use the financing that we have available are our nonprofit housing agencies that are going to be developing them now or later. The developers who don't typically, who's right now a market rate developer who their pro forma isn't working, doesn't generally then say, well, I've never done housing that is assisted before, and now I'm going to look at it. That isn't to say that it doesn't always happen, but it's a different, it's much more difficult to make the financing for those kinds of projects work. And so typically, if you're not used to doing it and it's not an area that you've had experience in, we don't see a lot of folks gravitate to that. That's not to say that it doesn't happen, but as a general rule, people who use those subsidies are nonprofit developers who have experience in working through those programs. I don't know if that's okay.
Can I just ask for a quick clarification? You said as soon as we rezone a piece of property, we have to build 20 units per acre. Is that correct? Because I'm assuming that everything we rezone, we're going to have to rezone everything we're going to use. Let's assume that. We have to use 20 units per acre as our starting point. Because that's what she said earlier, and I just want to clarify.
For sites that you need to accommodate your regional housing need that can't be accommodated without rezoning, yes, those sites have to allow a minimum density of 20 units. Correct.
Okay. And I encourage all of you to go to the Planning Commission meetings, because that's who's going to make a lot of our decisions. Go to the Planning Commission meetings so you can be involved in the decisions.
There's going to be no decisions made.
Yeah.
There is going to be a series of other workshops scheduled for November. There's going to be an ad hoc group of your peers that are going to be working on some solutions. There's no decision that's going to be made anytime soon. At some point, you're right, it will go to Planning Commission, it will go to Council. We're talking, you know, a series of months from now. So just, there's nothing immediate I want folks to clarify. So we've got just a few more questions.
I was asked to make a clarification. For the minimum density requirement there that we just talked about, it is only for those, you have a regional housing need allocation by a variety of income levels. That minimum density only applies to sites that you're rezoning to accommodate your lower income allocation. So if you had other sites that had to be rezoned or you wanted to rezone, they would not have a minimum density standard.
That's what we've got time for, so who's left in order?
Sure, we understand that you can. The city's website is still there. You can submit questions to the city at any time through Dave's office, through the website, and they will get back to you. And if your name is on this list over here, and if you haven't put it on there, put it on there, list the question, and they will get back to you. This is going to be a long-term process.
Okay, thank you. So this gentleman right here, and then we've got, I think he was ahead of you. Sorry. Then this gentleman, orange, and then we're going to be done. Few wrap up, and then thank you for your patience.
When the Hamilton project was built, that I think they took a big chunk, maybe a big portion of what Novato had to accommodate in that one area. And my understanding was that when that was completed, they didn't have the people. They built it, the people didn't come, and they had to go outside the Bay Area or throughout the Bay Area and invite and solicit people to fill that housing. And then as you mentioned, there's probably still some property allocation from that period of time when that housing element was done. We're working on this, I think, is the next housing element after that one. So we've been allocated, I think, somewhere in the neighborhood of 900 units for this element. Some big numbers, 700 or whatever it is. Now, that's going to require us to rezone properties in Novato to accommodate 700 units. When the next housing element comes and those aren't built, what happens? Is the state going to require us to allocate another bunch when these haven't been used? Where does it stop?
Well, I will at least explain. If you have... It's not my understanding, and I can't speak to all the, you know, whether or not you have to rezone to accommodate your entire need. But I would tell you, if you did have sites that were currently zoned, or you rezoned them, and no development occurred, and the next cycle, you can still use those sites. You don't have to start all over. If you've got a vacant piece of land or a land that site that you think could be redeveloped and it doesn't get developed in this planning period, you can use it your next planning period.
So to clarify for that, let's say we have 300 units out of our 600 that aren't developed. And let's say our next allocation is another 600 units. Do the 300 that are still sitting as opportunity sites, we're able to use that? So it's the gap then for the next 600, hypothetical, is 300. You're not finding a full six. Is that just
correct?
Broad
correct.
Categories?
Correct.
Okay. So this man in the orange shirt.
Hello. You stated that the main qualification for someone to get this housing is income level. Now, that is quite a privilege to get this housing. And like a driver's license, it is a privilege, not a right. Does the city of Novato have the ability to require that a person does not have a criminal record nor gets a criminal record? And if they get a criminal record while they are resident, they are out.
Property owner can establish rules and screening, and many property owners do have a screening related to both, you know, your ability to pay rent and as well as related to your criminal record. I don't know whether the city can establish a rule related to that, but property owners certainly can and do. No, I don't know that there aren't other constitutional or other issues. I'm saying that many property owners do institute those kinds of regulations. Whether a city could uniformly establish a blanket rule that if you have a criminal record, you could not live in the city, I don't think that there, I think there'd probably be constitutional issues. I can't speak to that. Well, I can't speak to that.
Okay, I guess I have the mic back on. I want to thank you all for coming.
You're welcome to come ask your question one-on-one, and again, we'll capture questions, and just that I want to be respectful of folks' time. They came at 6:30, it's 9:00, it's a work day tomorrow for a lot of folks, so. This conversation will continue. I apologize for cutting you off, but please walk up and ask it. Dave, if you please finish.
Yes. So I want to thank you all for coming. I know you had a lot of concerns with our guests, but hopefully I will thank them for coming. They took a lot of heat from you folks, and I'm sure that they learned a lot about your concerns about housing in Novato, and we'll be taking those into consideration as we proceed forward with working on a housing element. The next workshops that we're looking at are in the beginning of November. We have tentative dates of November 6th and November 13th. Those are Saturday mornings, just to let you know that those will be coming up. If you signed up on our list or have signed up previously with your email address, we will notify you of the details of those meetings. If you would like to be added to our list, please, you can go onto our website, the Housing Element website, and there's a spot to sign up. Just enter in your email address, and we will notify you of all future meetings. We were hoping that that would better accommodate folks. If that's not true, give us that input. Thank you all again for coming.